So thank you all for coming today. We're really excited to be able to host this talk. It's not at our regular time. We do have a lecture series on Wednesdays at 7 p.m., but we got an opportunity to host Susan Rogers today, and we just jumped on it. We're really excited that she's here. This is officially the fourth talk then on our series at the Sound Studies Institute. So I want to acknowledge, first of all, that we're SSI is part of the University of Alberta, which is located on Treaty 6 territory, which is a traditional gathering place for diverse Indigenous people, including the Cree, the Blackfoot, the Métis, the Nakota Sioux, Iroquois, Dene, Ojibwe, Inuit, and many others. SSI is committed to ensuring that these histories and languages and cultures continue to influence our vibrant community. And I just want to welcome everyone here. So if you're attending an SSI event for the first time, the Sound Studies Institute is a research institute at the University of Alberta that supports research and creative activities that centralize sound in any way. If it makes sound, we're really interested in it. SSI offers researchers opportunities to work collaboratively, discover new areas of inquiry, benefit from collective administrative support. And we provide a philosophical and physical locus for sharing and exploring and creating and collaborating across disciplines and across the university. So welcome to everyone. Thanks to Oliver Rossier, Tom Merklinger, and Gail Mandrick, the staff here. We're just gonna get right into today's talk. So as usual for a Zoom event, we'd like to ask, especially today, because I think we've got a lot of people coming in today, if we could keep your video off and audio muted during the presentation. And then we will have time at the end for questions, and we'll be doing that through the chat and through the blue hand mechanism, and I'll talk more about that at the end as we go. So this talk is just, I'm not going to read the whole description that's on the website, but really the gist of it is when record makers are making records and thinking about selling those records and getting those records out into the public, they're listening for certain kinds of things that they think are gonna be responsive, the public will respond to. And this talk is essentially about how music psychology can play a role in determining what actually works and what doesn't. Is there a scientific basis for being able to understand what moves listeners to buy records or to listen to music in general? And what better person to talk about this than Susan Rogers? She holds a doctorate degree in experimental psychology from McGill University in 2010. And prior to her career as a scientist, she was a multi-platinum earning record producer, engineer, mixer, and audio technician. She is best known, of course, for her work with Prince during his peak creative period during from 1983 to 1987. But her production and engineering credits go well beyond that, including David Byrne, Bare Naked Ladies, Geggy Ta, one of my favorite lesser known bands, great band, Nil Lara, and so many others that I could list here. Great stuff. She's a professor in the departments of music production and engineering and liberal arts at Berklee College of Music in Boston, where she teaches psychoacoustics, record production, and analog recording techniques. She's the director of the Berklee Music Perception and Cognition Laboratory for investigating the influence of musical training on the auditory pathway, which is just fascinating. She's currently authoring a book on music listening for Norton in New York City. And let's all welcome Susan here with a virtual applause in whatever way you'd like to express that. Welcome to you, Susan. Thank you.
Thank you, Scott. Thank you, folks, for having me. Special thanks to Peter Berg for the invitation. And the original invitation was issued a long time ago before COVID. And I said yes with great delight and anticipation. I was going to come to your campus. And I was very sad that COVID prevented that from happening. So I just have to make it up to myself someday and get out there because I've always wanted to see Alberta. And boy, would I like to be there with you. But in lieu of that, well, let's just, let's make do. So I'm gonna share the screen and I've got a slideshow presentation to give you. We're gonna talk about as Scott said, music psychology for record makers. We'll put a finer point on that at the very end of the talk, but I'll keep an eye on the clock and try not to go over time so we've got time for your questions. So quickly, some background to establish my credentials. When I was a little kid, like all little kids, I liked records. I was not a Sonny and Cher fan, but someone gave me this record for a birthday or something like that. And I remember I just turned 9 years old. And on the back of this record, you see crew members and a description of what they did. And that picture of Stan Ross, the sound engineer, I just stared at that picture. Something about it felt right. And we're going to return to that theme. It'll be a theme in this talk of recognizing your internal, that little voice inside. Something about it felt right because I knew I didn't want to be the secretary, and I didn't want to sew all of their clothes. And I also knew I didn't want to be a musician either. But I think I felt from an early age that I was born to be a record maker in some capacity. That dream came true. In 1978, I moved to Hollywood, which wasn't far away from where I was living in Southern California. And I began my career as an audio technician. In 1983, Prince had just come off the 1999 tour and he was getting ready to do Purple Rain. And he told his management that he needed a technician from New York or LA, as he said, because he wanted someone who'd been in the industry, in the music industry. And they found me, and I sure was glad they did because he was my favorite artist in the world. I moved out to Minnesota in 83, and man, did we do a lot of work. That Sign of the Times album was just reissued in this big deluxe box set just a few weeks ago, and Warner Brothers sent me the chart positions today in the US and in Europe and Japan, and it's selling like mad. And it's on the catalog charts, and it's on the main album charts as well in many countries, and couldn't be more proud. The record's 33 years old now. So after Prince, I came back to Los Angeles and worked as a record engineer, a record mixer, and then also as a record producer. Bare Naked Ladies came calling in 1998 and they asked if I could work with them on what was, I think, their fifth album, Stunt. And I was so delighted to be able to say yes, because I love those guys. And we worked together. I only had a few weeks. I was in between projects, but that record was hugely successful. And when you had a big successful record back in the olden days, well, you got a big paycheck, which you need to sell an awful lot more records today to get a lot of money in royalties, but whatever, back then we did. And when you'd get that big money, you had the option of paying off your mortgage, or you could build a studio or whatever. But I answered another call, and that was a call I had been feeling for some time. The desire to explore the sciences. I started becoming intensely interested in not just the human brain, but more specifically, I was interested in the minds of other species, and I still am. I wanted to be a cognitive ethologist. So I left the music business, thanks to Bare Naked Ladies, in the year 2000. I entered University of Minnesota as a freshman and did 4 straight years there, and then had the great good fortune to be accepted into McGill. You may not know, McGill is the mecca for music perception and cognition research. They have the highest concentration in the world, to the best of my knowledge, certainly then, and I think still today, the highest concentration of music perception and cognition researchers. So I got into McGill, into Dan Levitin's lab, and he decided to take a little time and write this book, This Is Your Brain on Music. It became a huge bestseller. After I left McGill and got my PhD, I was hired by Berklee to teach in 2 departments, record production and then also liberal arts, where I teach psychoacoustics. I've been at Berklee 12 years now. When we're making a record, whether it's as a producer or an engineer or an artist or a performer, composer, arranger, we record makers have to employ a running stream of decision making. And let me backtrack for just a moment and say by record, I mean recording. I don't necessarily mean vinyl. Whatever form it ends up in doesn't matter. You press the record button and you're making a recording. So we employ a running stream of decision making. Now, an interesting thing in cognitive psychology is the notion of categories. Categories don't exist in nature. An apple doesn't acknowledge that it's different than an orange. Human beings draw distinctions between apples and pears and things like that, and we say that these are two different things. We do it naturally. We do it constantly, all the time. A life in the arts is a life in problem solving. Whether you're a sculptor or a movie maker or a record maker, you are constantly deciding, and your work will be informed by the decisions that you make. Those decisions are informed by prior experience and creativity. So there, you're in the studio, you've got a problem to solve. This part isn't working. The clavinet through the wah-wah pedal isn't working. All right, so you've decided that much, but what will work? Well, you have to rely on what's worked in the past. You have to have internalized an awful lot of records, listened to a lot of music, and adopted the awareness of why it was working for you. So you can employ a solution to an artistic problem that you know will work, but if you want to be more creative, if you want to take a risk, if you want to push the envelope of what music is, you might try something that might not work. You're constantly balancing those two things. We keep a mental library of possible solutions so that we've always got something to fall back on. And the more records you've made, of course, the more possible solutions you have. It's harder for beginners. How do we know what will work? Nah, we don't. Should it be a Les Paul or a Strat? Should it be this microphone or that microphone? Don't know. You try it, and what you're doing is when you're trying it, you're listening to the auditory signal that you're processing right now. You're also comparing it to how it could sound, going back into auditory long-term memory to ask yourself, how could this be better? So this talk kind of has three parts. We're going to start with knowing yourself. Then we'll talk about integrating that self into other creative collaborative projects. And then lastly, we'll talk about knowing the listeners. This lecture comes to us from, I'm going to change something on my screen. I think you're seeing what I'm seeing. My mouse isn't available to me. All right, so I'll just say it. Oh, something outside in the alley. This lecture is from Bill Verplank. Bill Verplank is a Silicon Valley fellow credited with being one of the inventors of the computer mouse. He came to Dan Levitin's lab when I was a student there and gave the following talk, and it rocked my world. If only I had known about this when I was in the music business. Bill Verplank was talking about archetypes, archetypal thinkers specifically. The way we think is so important to building our careers. And in his case, he's talking about Paul Allen and Bill Gates and Steve Jobs and Steve Wozniak from Apple Computer and Microsoft. But I was thinking about myself and the folks I had worked with in the music business. So I'm going to share this with you. The first archetypal thinker is the artist, the visionary, the person who sees things that don't exist. The artistic thinker sees patterns that others miss, and they can invent things, whether it's a record or a software, they can invent things that others might not. Prince was a strong visionary, as were Stephen Page and Ed Robertson from Bare Naked Ladies, as was Tommy Jordan and Greg Kurstin from Geggy Top. But artists, for all their great ideas, lack often the capacity to actually get things made. There's a handicap to having your head in the clouds all the time. The artist needs another archetype. And that second type of thinker is the thinker who can build the prototype of the iPhone or the software or the record that you've just imagined in your head. These are my people. The way we interact with the world, the way we think, the way we solve problems is by using logic and reason and practical solutions. That's our go-to method of solving problems. It's how we, this archetype, think. So say an artist comes to you with a great idea, a vision for a great record, and you, engineer, help them build a home studio, and you get that record made. Well, now you got a problem once that record is made, because neither one of you knows how to sell it. Both of you are lacking in your concept of how complex human relationships work, how society works. You need another mind on it. For that, you're going to need the entrepreneur, according to Bill Verplank. Now, an entrepreneur is very strong in skills that the engineer tends to be weak in. Social skills, understanding human relationships, and bringing people together. An entrepreneur understands what people want and how to give people what they want. I don't know if you're like me, but if you are, you might not be good at this kind of thinking. These are opposite ends of this quadrant here. Now, as Bill Verplank was giving this lecture that I saw in grad school, I'm thinking, I'm not getting it, because I'm thinking of Bare Naked Ladies, who sold, I believe, 5 million copies of the Stunt album. And I'm also thinking of Gegita. And Gegita sold maybe 250,000 of their best-selling record. In these collaborative projects, we had strong visionaries, strong artists. They both had me in common. They were two projects that I worked on, so I was capable of both producing and engineering at the same time. And we didn't have any technical difficulties there. We were fine there. In the case of Bare Naked Ladies, the guys in the band were strong in the entrepreneurial sense. They are geniuses at interacting with their fans, and they are actually pioneers in many ways when it comes to taking your artistry and connecting with your fans. But Gegita, they had David Byrne. They were on David Byrne's label. Why wasn't Gegita as successful? What were we missing? The answer was Gegita was missing the fourth archetype. And Bare Naked Ladies had him. The fourth archetype is the competitor. In Bill Verplank's language, he called it the bully. But I don't want to call that person the bully, because this person isn't necessarily a bully. The manager for Bare Naked Ladies was the great Terry McBride of Network Management. Terry was no bully, at least not as far as I knew. He was well-liked, a lovely guy. But the archetype of the competitor is a person whose joy and satisfaction is in winning. To many artists, that's the complete opposite of how they like to think. Artists don't tend to like thinking competitively. This is why Bill Verplank had these two as opposites on this axis. It's important when you're building your team to have people who represent these different archetypes. Don't try to be a person who is smack in the center, because if you're sitting right in the center and you're a little bit of everything, you won't be strong at any one of them. Now, I've known people, Prince was one of them, who was strong in both. He was a strong artist and he was very competitive. Certainly Michael Jackson was too. Bare Naked Ladies were strong artistically and strong entrepreneurially. It doesn't mean these things can't coexist. It just means that you're going to need a team that is going to include people who think this way. And that will increase your chances of success. So I teach students that when they're starting their professional careers, one of the first things they need to do is know themselves and to figure out what kind of thinker they are, so that they can join collaborative endeavors that need someone just like them and where their contribution will actually make a difference. Now we're going to talk about what kind of listener you are. And this also comes to us from psychology. The x-axis here is stimulus complexity, and the y-axis is music consumption, sales or just streaming or whatever. What we know is that when human beings interact with stimuli, whether it's food or fashion or music or movies or whatever, when we interact with things out there in the world, we like our stimuli to match our individual sweet spot for how simple it is versus how complex it is. Now, when it comes to music, you can go ahead and superimpose familiarity and novelty onto this, because most of us in the developed industrialized world have heard modern pop music. one form or another. So we're all pretty familiar with it. So when it comes to music, on the far left hand of the side of the curve, we've got the most simple music of all, and that would be children's music. It's repetitive phrases, short consonant repetitive phrases at moderate tempos. And the reason children's music needs to be that way is that makes it easy for little toddlers to memorize these short repetitive phrases. And in memorizing these phrases, they can move along, they can sing along, and they can be part of the music listening experience because they can predict what's coming. It's simple for those little developing brains. It is way too simple for an adult or a teenage brain. It's too competitive. On the far right side of the curve, we have the most complex music that strives to be the least predictable. Freeform jazz comes to mind. Freeform jazz tries to subvert the rules of Western tonal music so that you can't predict what is coming. Consequently, it's so complex that if you're really going to listen to it, you kind of have to be an active, not a passive listener. You have to sort of commit to sitting down and internalizing it and hearing it over and over and over again so you can have the joy of predicting what's coming. And that's very hard to do because it strives to be very unpredictable. I'm thinking of Ornette Coleman and Anthony Braxton and Pharoah Sanders and some folks who were pioneers of free jazz. Free jazz doesn't sell a lot either. The vast majority of us prefer popular music. Popular music or pop music sits right in the sweet spot for most listeners of just the right blend of novelty and familiarity, simplicity and complexity. There'll be enough familiar items, like eight bar sections, for example, or consonant musical intervals, enough familiar items that we get it and we don't have to waste a lot of mental energy listening to it because we get it. We've already internalized these simple rhythms. We've internalized eight bar sections. We've internalized how Western tonal music goes. So when you have enough familiar items, your attention is going to naturally drift toward the novel items on top of all that. And those novel items might be novel lyrics, it might be novel sound design, it might be novel chord changes. It might be, let's say you're Timbaland and you're producing in the late 90s or the early 2000s. It might be novel rhythms. You might leave out beats where we expect to hear them. But that just right blend of novelty and familiarity is what you'll find at the top of the pop charts. Folks who like their music on the left side of the median here, we can call it classic music, not to be confused with classical, but music that's on the left side of that curve is music with very familiar forms. That would be rock and bluegrass and folk, bebop jazz, any form of music where the form is really well known. Reggae is a perfect example. If you're going to buy new music in a well-known, familiar genre, you're going to be listening for expertise in a very predictable item. On the opposite side of the curve, if you like your music on the right side, you're not necessarily listening for a familiar form. What your appetite is craving is complexity and new ideas. You would rather have more novelty, and you'll take a poorly executed record with a high dose of novelty over an impeccably executed record in a familiar form. Note the symmetry of this curve, and this is broad strokes. This isn't based on any empirical or research data. It's broad strokes. The bell curve is very familiar to anyone who studies the life sciences and behavior. It tends to, if you get a large enough number, it tends to distribute itself like this. Anyway, if you like records on the left side of the curve, you will value craft and technique over art. If you like the right side of the curve, you'll tend to value art or original thinking over craft. The cool thing about this graph is that it's constantly moving forward. I put the blue dot there on the right side because that's where my taste has been my whole life. And I would argue that most listeners have a sweet spot here on this bell curve, and that's where they'll be throughout their lives. My appetite for novelty is stronger than someone else's, but this curve can be applied to other kinds of stimuli like food or fashion or movies. I like my art movies and I like my prize-winning highbrow kind of books and novels, but I like conservative fashion and conservative food. I don't have adventurous tastes there. Anyway, my blue dot has always been right about there to the right of pop music. And what's cool about that is that this thing is constantly moving forward. Sometimes bands that are far out in front of the curve, Tennyson, I'm going to refer to them again in this talk, but Tennyson, whom I love, or Gegita, or some other bands that are a little bit avant-garde, sometimes all they have to do is keep doing what they're doing. And if they have enough imitators, the curve will catch up with them. We're talking about knowing yourself. So if you're a young professional and you're embarking on a career in the music business, you should always consider what you want and who you are. You should consider your motives and your strengths. You stand the best chance of success if you can combine the two and work in the zone where what you truly want, your desires, matches your natural abilities. By natural abilities, I'm talking about the type of thinker you are. Bill Verplank's archetypes is one way to begin. There are many ways of thinking about our cognitive profile. Anyway, look for that overlap where what you want overlaps with who you are. What you want is desire. It's desire. But desire is different from intention. Because if we're going to get anywhere, we have to think about cause and effect. What I want is a clean car. That's my desire. I want my car to be clean. But until I say, and I intend to wash it on Saturday, that car's not going to get clean. Desire itself, this is especially important for me to share with students, because sometimes some of them will adopt the wrong thinking of thinking that belief is really what you need. Belief is the main thing you need, but belief does nothing to actually make something happen. You still have to put one step in front of the other, and you have to have intentionality. Desires are so valuable. There's a new area of focus right now in cognitive psychology that focuses on mind wandering and the neural pinnings of that. It's called the default network. Such a good name for it, because the default network refers to where your mind goes when it can go wherever it wants, when it's playtime for your brain, when you don't have a problem to solve, you don't have a task to perform, you're not watching television, you're not looking at the screen, you're not texting, you're not talking on the phone. And you don't have an activity that you must do, and your brain is free to travel to its happy place, it will. That dreaming fuels your mind-wandering fantasies, and those fantasies are the forerunner of your creativity. Creative thought is a manifestation, or it leads to a manifestation, of your daydreams and your fantasies. It is underappreciated in adults. The adults who daydream, and I think all creative folks do, are the adults who are giving themselves permission to have their heads in the clouds and think artistically. Once you are finished thinking of something that's creative and original and new, you get right to the craft of it, and that's when you can employ goal-directed thought. So as you're pondering what you want out of this career and out of this life, also be thinking about your intentionality, the steps you'd like to take, who you are, what sort of thinker you are, and see if you can combine the two. In my own life, what I wanted, just in general, was to be where records were being made. Who I was an engineering type thinker. So I started my career as an audio technician. That green zone worked out for me. Right, I want to play you some music clips now to illustrate a point. All of these are records that I've worked on. But the point I want to make in this second part of the lecture is how you as a creative individual will have to integrate yourself into creative projects, whether it's as a sound designer or an arranger, a composer, or artist, engineer, producer, whatever. You're bringing your artistry into the room. I started earlier by talking about the mental library. All the music that you've ever listened to in your life creates a filter through which everything you're listening to now must pass. That's what we say in music cognition. So when you walk into the room with creative artists, you're bringing your mental library, and you're also bringing with you what you want, your appetite for how you like music to go. So these artists all represent quite a variety in different styles of music, but in every single one of them, whether some of them I worked as the engineer, some the mixer, and several of them the producer, on these records, I was shaping it in combination with the artist's vision to help make it something I wanted to hear, my own ear. Let's listen to some sections. And I think you might notice when you listen to these clips, a couple of things that they all have in common. I have a strong sense of rhythm. We'll return to the formal elements of music in a moment. I have a strong love of and desire for rhythm. And I'm pretty good at producing vocals because I read a lot and I love lyrics. So I have a sharp ear for lyrics. Those are my strengths. I have quite a few weaknesses, as we all do. But those two things I'm strong in. So listen for the rhythm and the vocal performance. Here we go. Now it's crumb inside each head. There's a piece that's small and dumb. Something's big and beautiful. Give it time.
Star ever, ever seen had its picture in a magazine. It looked like a motorcycle coming at you through my glazed glass shower door.
Over the valley, under the sea. There is a new wave rise with me.
Yeah, right here we're
over the valley.
All that I have, I'll give to you. Your love is unspoken. Do you feel the same way too? Will the days go by and we watch your intentions die? This I
left in America anymore. They left after the Second World War, heading west, stopping briefly in Japan during the 60s, and in Tiananmen Square during the last decade. They kept heading west to who knows where. What are they after?
It's the joy of record making when you can contribute to something. All of these artists are so strong and such good players, and it's a wonderful feeling knowing that your artistry can be combined with theirs. I wonder why it won't advance. Oh no. All right, hang on. Let me share it again. Hang on, here we go. All right. I want to share this 3-minute video with you. I tell students sometimes that, well, it's very informative. You're going to hear it narrated by Derek Sievers. Derek Sievers was the founder of CD Baby. He went to Berklee when he was much younger. What you're going to see here is someone holding a phone and taking a video of this guy dancing at an outdoor show. And you're going to see the dancing guy being joined by a couple of first followers. And you're going to see what happens. Specifically, you're going to see a movement happen in under 3 minutes. Gegita used to say, this is a 3-minute description of how our success is going to go.
If you've learned a lot about leadership and making a movement, then let's watch a movement happen start to finish in under 3 minutes and dissect some lessons. First, of course, a leader needs the guts to stand alone and look ridiculous. But what he's doing is so simple, it's almost instructional. This is key. You must be easy to follow. Now here comes the first follower with a crucial role. He publicly shows everyone else how to follow. Notice how the leader embraces him as an equal. So it's not about the leader anymore, it's about them, plural. Notice how he's calling to his friends to join in. See, it takes guts to be a first follower. You stand out and you brave ridicule yourself. Being a first follower is an underappreciated form of leadership. The first follower transforms a lone nut into a leader. If the leader is the flint, the first follower is the spark that really makes the fire. Now here's the second follower. This is a turning point. It's proof the first has done well. Now it's not a lone nut, and it's not two nuts. Three is a crowd, and a crowd is news. A movement must be public. Make sure outsiders see more than just the leader. Everyone needs to see the followers, because new followers emulate followers, not the leader. Now here come two more people, then three more immediately. Now we've got momentum. This is the tipping point, and now we have a movement. As more people jump in, it's no longer risky. If they were on the fence before, there's no reason not to join in now. They won't stand out, they won't be ridiculed, and they will be part of the in crowd if they hurry. And over the next minute, you'll see the rest who prefer to stay part of the crowd, because eventually they'd be ridiculed for not joining. And ladies and gentlemen, that is how a movement is made. So let's recap what we've learned. If you are a version of the shirtless dancing guy, all alone, remember the importance of nurturing your first few followers as equals, making everything clearly about the movement, not you. Be public, be easy to follow. But the biggest lesson here, did you catch it? Leadership is over-glorified. Yes, it started with the shirtless guy, and he'll get all the credit, but you saw what really happened. It was the first follower that transformed a lone nut into a leader. There's no movement without the first follower. See, we're told that we all need to be leaders, but that would be really ineffective. The best way to make a movement, if you really care, is to courageously follow and show others how to follow. When you find a lone nut doing something great, have the guts to be the first person to stand up and join in.
It looks like we've got an unstable connection. I think am I back now? Yes? Oh, hello?
Your audio is back. Your video kind of froze.
Oh, okay. What I was saying is that every sentence that Derek Sievers is saying there is true and important. It's important for record makers to understand. So think of the shirtless dancing guy as a lone nut, an artist doing something great that might be ahead of that bell curve. That's what Gegita was for me, and they changed my career. They were lone nuts doing music that was kind of difficult to follow. But when I, as the producer, as the first follower, joined them and said, yeah, this band is great, these guys are talented, they embraced me as the shirtless dancing guy did to the first fellow in the green shirt who came up. He embraced him. And as Derek Sievers said, he made it about what they were doing, not about himself. It would not have been effective if the shirtless dancing guy wanted the attention all to himself. Now let's talk about knowing listeners, and we'll talk about the three basic systems that human beings have for bonding with and falling in love with a piece of music. We've got our motor system. Music is very, very effective at making us move. Human beings have thick, vast neural tracts that go from our auditory cortex right above our ears to our motor cortex right kind of at the top of our head there. So human beings are very adept and inclined to put sound and motion together. We've got an emotion system that responds to the sounds of love and devotion, the sounds of danger. We've got an emotion system that is moved by certain musical gestures, even if there's no drums there or no lyrics there. And we've got a cognitive system that can cognitively appraise a record and decide if it's smart, it's clever, if it's innovative. The cognitive system is the one that often kicks in to help explain why we're dancing to this record or why we're feeling something to it. The motor system makes us move, of course, the emotion system makes us feel, and the cognitive system makes us think. The elements of music that are most likely to give rise to these responses are, of course, the rhythm, the groove, and the tempo, if you're going to move to it. If you're going to feel an emotion, that's probably going to come from the melody or the chord progression, the harmony, sometimes timbre. And especially when we're teens, we are likely to choose music for the lyrics because music helps us solve problems. When we're teenagers and we're trying to fit into a social environment, we need to know how to talk to that guy or how to talk to that girl or how to make the other kids notice us or respect us or how to get our parents off our back. You put on that record and that singer talks to you and gives you those words, the words you'd like to say. What happens then when someone takes care of us when we're hurting? When someone takes care of us when we're hurting, we bond to them. And that's why people often fall in love with an artist or band in their teens, and they will have a soft spot in their hearts for that artist their whole lives. So speaking of listeners and that, what sorts of fantasies you like to have when you listen to music, after you've chosen your favorite records based on how they make you move or feel or whatever, what happens when you're listening to it? Where do you go? My current research project that I've got going on with a colleague right now is we're interested in this question. And we asked over nearly 1,700 listeners in the United States to tell us what they visualized when they listened to their favorite music. And we're talking about listening just for recreation. This all got started when my co-author and research partner, Ogie, he and I were comparing what we saw in our mind's eye every time we listened to music. And I said to him, since I was a little kid, my whole life, when I'm listening to the music I love, I visualize the performers. I always have. It's my favorite fantasy. It's where my mind wants to be. Of course, sometimes I try to pretend that, oh, that's me playing piano, that's me singing. I can never hang on to that fantasy. My natural self wants to see the musicians play in the studio or on stage, and that's what I will mentally visualize. And Ogie said, I don't see anything like that. I said, what do you see? And he said, I see science fiction. I see worlds that don't exist. I see abstract shapes and colors. So we began asking people, and we got a great variety of responses from just Mother Nature. Sometimes people see the woods, or the trees, they see the ocean. Sometimes people see abstract shapes and colors. Some people don't see anything at all. There is a portion of the population that is aphantastic, meaning they lack the ability to have visual imagery. And then some people, of course, see themselves and their friends. Our data shows that the most common visualization experienced while listening to music was basically yourself, your own memories, memories of the people and places that this music prompts. Well, Ogie and I both looked at each other when we saw this data and we went, wow, that's strange, because neither one of us enjoys experiencing that when we listen to our favorite music. The second most common visualization was seeing the story in the lyrics. We had people write to us and say that they make up stories based on the lyrics and they visualize like mini movies in their heads when they listen to their favorite music. Many people, like myself, see the artist performing, either in concert, that was the more common answer, or in the recording studio. Many people see themselves performing. Then there were the folks that saw imaginary worlds, like Ogie. They saw the worlds that don't exist. And then there were the folks who saw the real world. And slightly less than 10% of people told us that they don't visualize anything. This is important for record makers to understand. Listeners are choosing records for different types of rewards, and we're not all the same. How do our listener profiles form? Well, culture, exposure, and your appetite for risk will help determine why you like the music that you like. Culture, because young people in different generations have to solve different problems. The problems of teenagers in the 1950s is very different than the problems of teenagers today. So the music that is going to mostly lyrically appeal to the kids of today is, of course, going to be lyrically different than what it would be in the 1950s. Culture has an influence on the music that we love because it has an influence on the problems we're solving. Exposure is a big part of it. When you're exposed to something new, and if you see on the right, I've got Vegemite, and on the left, I got bananas. When you're exposed to something new, you've got two systems that are at work. One is a reward system, and the other is the aversion system. And the aversion system is saying, don't do it, don't try it, don't try it. And the reward system is saying, but I want to, and you try it. If it works out for you, you will be more inclined to take a risk later. When I was a kid, anytime I was exposed to new music through friends or neighbors, when I was exposed to new music, it worked out for me. I liked it. And that's put me on the right side of the bell curve. In contrast, when I was exposed to new foods and I tried it, I'll never forget Vegemite, the first time I tried that, it didn't work out so well. Not too happy about that. I have conservative taste in food, adventurous taste in music. These profiles develop over years, starting in childhood. This is my last slide. I encourage all of you as record makers and as record consumers to recognize and appreciate your resonant frequency. For this book that we are writing right now, we went around and we asked a lot of people, young and old, to describe the experience of falling in love with a record that they fell in love with so hard, it was love at first sight, and they've loved that record for years. Here's some of the things they said. This person said, it's both threatening and inviting, but it conjures up a feeling of who I am. This person says, I'm still in love with it with my 44-year-old brain, but it brings me back to my 15-year-old self. It's more than a memory. I become 15 again. This person said, I get a feeling of empathy for the performance, but also a solitary feeling. There is so much internal adventure in there. This person said, it made me feel like a free spirit. It mirrored how I was living. The point is, we all have our own sweet spot. We all have our own appetite. We all have our own desire and risk reward system when it comes to music. Record makers would be well advised to recognize we won't please everybody. Let's aim to please the people whose resonant frequency is close to our own and let the rest do their own thing. There'll be records for them and for you. Thank you. That's all I got.
Hey. That was fantastic. Okay, so what I might suggest is understanding that some people are going to need to leave. You know, it is Friday, and I think that we can take some time for questions now.
Or it was gone for a minute.
Oh, did I go away?
Yeah, and I wanted to point out.
My apologies.
Oh no, no, I don't think it's us. I think it's Zoom. I have done speed checks on my internet during a freeze, and I can see that it's not our internet. I think it's Zoom. Just too much traffic.
Okay.
I see that Patricia Derbyshire she was the first one with her hand up, so I'd like to take a question if we've got time.
I think I'm here. Can you hear me?
Yep.
Yes.
Okay, I have a loud train going by. Susan, thank you so much, Scott, and the group from U of A. Thanks for hosting. Susan, I've got an interesting album in front of me right now. It's a two-piece, and they started the project last October, and they finished it last month. And the album starts out pre-pandemic, and it is very, very clear that the pandemic has influenced the latter. I almost feel like I'm listening to two albums.
Wow.
I should identify as being on the entrepreneur competitor side. That's my role with this group. And given your conversation today, or the dialogue you've opened up, I feel like I want to position it across this spectrum that you've described in terms of the listener profile. It's my first time looking at this kind of challenge. So just thoughts about something that starts out very poppy and erodes into this beautiful kind of Radiohead Queens of the Stone Age vibe by the end.
Nice. Yeah, it's
Thank you. The
more innovative something is, of course, the further it is positioned on the right side of the bell curve. But as I was trying to say, and I don't think I said it very eloquently, but the curve is fairly symmetrical. So records that are out in front of the curve sell just as many as records that are behind the curve. You know, they're equal place on the y-axis. But the thing to know about the curve is that it's always moving forward and not backward. We are always collectively as a society, we've got an appetite for greater complexity and more novelty. Once something becomes old hat, we want to have something new. Record makers would be wise to be aware of that as they are introducing novelty into their creative works. I started the presentation by talking about that running stream of decision-making, and you've got your stock solutions to problems that you know will work, but the risk about the stock solutions is that it'll be boring. You won't be innovating enough. So you're constantly balancing just how much innovation you're willing to put into your work. And in what area? You know, will you innovate rhythmically, innovate melodically, innovate lyrically?
Can I attempt to ask a nerdy question about kind of about your integrating yourself into a project? I really love your bass sound, and I'm kind of wondering if you have a typical production process for miking basses or for DIing basses, or even just, you know, what your process is for that, and if it varies drastically, or if you always have a particular approach. Thanks. Thank you.
Yeah, that's a funny thing. You know, men and women do hear slightly differently. The presence of estrogen affects how we hear. So there are slight differences between us. And in general, women tend to have a, give a slightly greater priority to and have a greater fondness for bass, and men, it's more the high frequencies. The Odds from Vancouver, the first band that I played, whom I worked with in the 90s, they gave me a little bowling trophy and they labeled the bowling ball lump of lows, and they called me the queen of low end. It's definitely true. I love that bass, and love that groove and that rhythm. As far as tips go, bass, I think, is the most important instrument on a popular record because it has the dual capacity to go down in the bottom, in the basement, and just play the rhythm with the drums, or it could go up top and play the chord progression or even play the melody. The great bass player is going to really have an ear for harmony. The best of the best really have an ear for harmony. And those great bass players know how to thread the needle right in between rhythm and chord progression melody. And they'll give you that deep harmony. They'll flesh out your record. When you've got a great bass player, it's really 90% of it. The other percent is sculpting the tones so that the bass is performing the function you need it to perform in your record. Drums, for example, you just assess it. I mean, is it tight or isn't it? Is your kick drum taking the lowest frequencies, or is your bass taking the lowest frequencies, and why? And what should happen in this record? Think of yourself very much when you're making records like a painter. And it's similar in some ways. So it's frequencies, different frequencies, much, much lower, of course, than visual frequencies. But you're asking yourself where you want that spotlight of attention to go, and you're balancing the frequency spectrum, just like you would balance colors in a painting. You're also balancing the direct signal with the reverberant signal. That's light versus shadow. If you play with sound sculpture, you'll pick up what works and what doesn't work for you, and just keep going from there. It's so much of it is so instinctual, but it's based on all the music that we like. Find those good bass players and listen to records with great bass players, and that'll be your best education.
Since things seem to be working better now, all of a sudden, this is great. I'm going to follow up that question with a quick, one thing I really wonder about is, in this day and age, at least within the last 10 years, according to the statistics that I've read, a large majority of people listen to their music on their laptop speakers, which of course is always like something that we complain about, like as composers, we want people to hear that low end. So I just wonder if there's any best practices that go into making records nowadays, given that, or is there, I mean, obviously I understand that you can't make two versions of a mix, one for laptop speakers and one for, you know, headphones or regular speakers, but it does seem to be a phenomenon that I wonder, there must be some strategy that's discussed among engineers about that.
I know that there is, although I've never employed it. So I stopped making records in 2000 when I left to go to college, and all the records I made were analog. So in my day, the bass and all the whole frequency spectrum that we manipulated and molded and shaped was to be mastered for vinyl, mastered for CDs. But today's mastering engineers have to deal with mastering for so many different delivery devices. And as you said, you can't control what someone is going to play it on, but it's a little disheartening to know that so many folks are listening on earbuds and on small speakers that can't physically reproduce the low frequencies the way that you would like. So what you have to do, as mixers and producers, no doubt, I'm not speaking from practical experience, but speaking as the psychoacoustician, you have to favor the higher order harmonics of your lower instruments, because you're simply not going to reproduce them. So you got to favor those harmonics and learn to be a real sculptor with EQ, so you get it to sound deeper than what it is. I don't know how those sound examples that I played for you guys during the presentation, I don't know how it sounded on your listening devices at home. On my iMac speaker here, I'm satisfied with the low end, but I'm not. I wasn't listening. I don't listen for that. When I listen to records, I'm listening for the music in it, not for the sounds of it. In fact, if you're listening to the sound of it, maybe the engineer did something wrong. The funny thing about being a mixer is that if you've really done your job well, all of your work is invisible.
Right.
No one will hear it. They'll never hear that mix. All they will ever hear is the music. That's the goal, is to carve yourself out of that picture so that you're not there.
So we're at one, maybe I'll just ask if there's one more like bleeding question someone has. We'll take one more question and then we'll call it a day, I think. Anyone else wanna jump in? No, looks like everyone's ready for lunch. So
all right.
At least around here.
I loved Kelsey's question about how you made a transition from kind of producing to academia, and then if you're still producing today.
No, I don't produce anymore because I was right when that little voice was calling to me about being in the sciences. It was a real voice. I love it. And the science work that I do now is my new love. And music, I'm no longer married to. I am not committed to music anymore. Music is now just my hobby. I'm committed to something else. But that worked out really well because I'd much rather see the youth of today making records. Popular music is by, for, and about young people. So young people should be making it. And I'm genuinely thrilled, like a stage mother, to see my students engineering and mixing and producing.
Okay, well, thank you so much for this. This has been fantastic.
Great. I look forward to talking. Yeah, thank you. I look forward to talking with Peter about Prince stuff. Bye.
Have a great afternoon. Bye-bye.